Kunda Vihari, Nitya Krishna, Radha Kunda. month of Kartik. Hopefully everybody is having a wonderful Kartik month, celebrating these most wonderful festivals and bringing our consciousness to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is the goal. So today I thought we could discuss the slaying of Arista, the bull demon, and the appearance of Radha Kunda. And indeed today we read Srila Prabhupada's introduction to chapter 36 of the 10th chapter. And we read the first verse and so forth and then a couple of verses and discuss a little bit about the killing of Aristasura and then the appearance of Radha Kunda. And then we'll discuss at the end the most wonderful festival that is celebrated in Sikhismola and Gandhi. And then that is the most, the most celebrated festival the whole year is in the temple in the Mali. Most celebrated. So Prabhupada Sikhismola. The grandest of all celebrations. It's very wonderful and very festive to be discussing the okay? So chapter 36, the slaying of Arista, the bull demon, so 45 writes. This chapter describes how Krishna killed Aristasura and how Kamsa reacted when he learned from Narada that Krishna and Balaram were the sons of Vasudeva. The demon Arista wanted to kill Krishna and Balaram, and thus he assumed the form of a huge bull with sharp horns. Everyone in Krishna's childhood village became terrified with Aristasura approached him. But the Lord pacified them, and when the bull demon charged him, he seized him by the horns and threw him about 6 yards. Though weakened, Aristasura still wanted to attack Krishna. Thus, dripping with sweat, he charged the Lord once again. This time Krishna grabbed his horns, threw him to the ground, and thrashed him like a pile of wet clothing. The demon vomited blood and gave up his life. Then Krishna and Rama, while being honored by the demigods and cowherd boys, returned to the village. Okay? I'll read the first verse. That is just the first two paragraphs of the introduction. So the first verse says, Sukadeva Goswami said, the demon Arista then came to the cowherd village, appearing in the form of a bull with a large hump. He made the earth tremble and he tore it apart with his hood. According to the Sri Vishnu Purana, Aristasura entered Krishna's village at twilight as the Lord appeared to dance with the gopis. Once, midday through the period of dusk, when Lord Janardana was eager to perform the Rasa dance, Arista madly entered the cowherd village, terrifying everyone.
Om Shri Guru.
Aristasura led to Krishna manifesting Radha Kunda, first Shanti, then Radha Kunda, and the we celebrated at the early part of Kartik, the appearance of Radha Kunda. This happened, the pastime of the swaying of Nitya, and the appearance of Shanti and Radha Kunda occurred during the auspicious month of Kartik, and we discussed this. So first, we'll establish the importance of Radha Kunda, why so many pastimes to fix. So we only have so many weeks on Friday, and it's just going to be very selective. So why this pastime? Well, Srila Rupa Goswami, in the next of instruction, he spoke only 11 verses. 11 verses he gave in this next of instruction. And in three of them, he establishes the glory of Radha Kunda. So you can see, you know, when you only have 11 verses, you have only so much space. And in three of them, he speaks about Radha Kunda. So I thought I would read these verses just to give us an indication of the extraordinary significance of Radha Kunda. And then we'll talk about how it appears. So in verse 9 of this Nectar instruction, this is Goswami writes, "The holy place known as Mathura is spiritually superior to Vaikuntha, the transcendental world, because the Lord appeared there. Superior to Mathura is the transcendental forest of Vrindavan, because of Krishna's Lasa Lila pastime. And superior to the forest of Vrindavan is Govardhan, for it was raised by the divine hand of Sri Krishna, and it was the site of his various loving pastime. And, above all, the super excellent Sri Radha Kunda stands supreme, for it is overflooded with ambrosial nectarine flavor of the Lord of Gokul, Sri Krishna. Where, then, is that intelligent person who is unwilling to serve the divine Radha Kunda, which is situated at the foot of the Golden Hill?" So I see the Rupa Goswami in this verse is giving, after explaining how to practice devotional service in the different steps in the first 8 verses, he is now speaking, where is the topmost place to practice devotional service? And where is that place? It is the super excellent, highest of all places. So in the whole of creation, he says, Mathura is even superior than Vaikuntha. Beyond our conception. Mm-hmm. That is a fact. Because Krishna personally appears there. Krishna doesn't appear in Vaikuntha. But in Mathura, he is walking barefoot, his bare feet touch all of the material. So within that, we see this Radha Kunda is the most nectarian place, the most potent place to practice devotional service. And why? Because it overflowed with the ambrosial nectarine flame. This Radha Kunda, Krishna flame, is overflowing at Radha Kunda. So in text 10, more discussion. In the Shastra, it is said that all types of fruit of workers, he who is advanced in knowledge of the higher values of life is favored by the Supreme Lord Hari. Out of many such people who are advanced in knowledge, jnani, one who is practicing liberated by the virtue of knowledge may take the devotional service. He is superior to the others. However, one who has attained prema, pure love of Krishna, is superior to him. The gopis are exalted above all advanced devotees, because they are totally dependent on Sri Krishna, the transcendental power of God. Among the gopis, Srimati Radharani is most dear to Krishna. Her kunda, lake, is as profoundly dear to Lord Krishna as is most beloved of gopis. Who then will not reside at Radha Kunda and in a spiritual body surcharged with ecstatic devotional feeling, opposite bond, render loving service to the divine help of Sri Radha Govinda, who perform their Ashtakaliya Lila, their eternal eightfold daily pastime. Indeed, those who execute devotional service on the banks of Radha Kunda are the most fortunate people in the universe. Most fortunate in the universe. Those who execute devotional service on the banks of Radha Kunda. Out of the many objects of favored delight, as in chapter 11, and of all the lovable damsels of Rajabhumi, Srimati Radharani is certainly the most treasured object of Krishna's love. And in every respect, her divine kund is described by great sages as similarly dear to him. Undoubtedly, Radha Kunda is very rarely attained, even by the great devotees. Therefore, it is even more difficult for ordinary devotees to attain. If one simply bathes once within the holy water, one's pure love of Krishna is fully aroused. You can't even imagine how glorious Radha Kunda is. You can just understand, as dear as Srimati Radharani is this Radha Kunda. Krishna is so attractive to this Radha Kunda. And as dear as Srimati Radharani is this Radha Kunda. And if one bathes once in Radha Kunda, what are they assured? Krishna prema. Assured Krishna prema. Radha Kunda is very difficult to achieve, even for the very advanced devotees. Anybody who's been to Radha Kunda? All of us can be able to go to her, to go back to Radha Kunda Radha here. We can honor and pray that we can attain the pure love of Krishna. Because this Radha Kunda is the most potent place where Krishna prema is overflowing. And we'll see why in a moment. And we have some many evidences of its greatness. But actually Radha Kunda and Shyama Kunda, they reside eternally in the spiritual world. And how they manifested in the spiritual world is described in the Adi Kundalini, that Krishna and Srimati Radharani were enjoying many of their pastimes. And in one transcendental pastime, they were taking each other's mood. And in that mood, they were searching for each other, and there was extreme pain of separation. Their love is so intense that when they are separated for even a few moments, they become overwhelmed in transcendental grief. Not on the pure grief. And so they were shedding tears and tears of love and separation. And Krishna is shedding tears and he filled the whole food and became Shamsun. And Srimati Radharani is shedding tears. Tears of love. And that became Goloka Radharani. So this Radha eternally exists in the spiritual world. That's for our benefit that Radha Kunda and Shyama Kunda also appear in the material world. But not in the material world. In Vrindavan, which is non-different from the spiritual world. And very, very difficult to achieve. But by the mercy of Srila Prabhupada, we have a chance. My way to go to Vrindavan, take a taxi, go to Govardhan, they take you to Radha Kunda, anything else. Not quite that easy. You need a passport stamped by Srimati Radharani. But if you ask her, so how we would even know to ask to go to Radha Kunda? How many of us knew about Radha Kunda before reading from Srila Prabhupada's book? Anybody knew what Radha Kunda was? So, one who opens her eyes to this type of knowledge, we are eternally indebted. And Prabhupada presenting these, gave us evidence and great knowledge of how to approach Radha Kunda. Very difficult for great, great devotees. I could speak of us as neophytes. and weak. But it's only by the mercy of the Lord and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was performing his pastime, he instructed the six performers to go to Vrindavan, particularly Rupa and Sanatana Goswami. And he said, you excavate all the lost places of Vrindavan. 500 years ago, all the holy places of Vrindavan were overcome by forests and jungles. It was indescript. You could not find. And Rupa and Sanatana Goswami, you know, identified the place of Janrasa and identified the different bathing Vasani and Mana and Fayagra, all these different places. Sanatana Goswami established, they built temples and established and marked these are the holy places in the world. But one place, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself came to discover, which is fire. He came specifically to Vrindavan, which is plainly taken up in some way, to find and uncover. So you can see how extraordinary and important it is. These Prabhupada comments in the purpose of that verse we read from that instruction, proving and establishing the great significance of Radha Kunda, that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself went and personally identified this is Radha Kunda, as he says. By many different angles, we see it is the most important place that can go on spiritual work, spiritual life. We have the great mercy of Srila Prabhupada and Guru Sahaja. We can have an opportunity to go to Radha Kunda. Take advantage. And we take advantage by rendering devotional service. By sitting on the bench and chanting the holy name of the Lord and imagining the sweetness of this place. That Krishna and Srimati Radharani come to every day. That Krishna bathes in Radha Kunda every day, still today. Between 10 and 3 o'clock. And Srimati Radharani and her friends bathe every day in still, you can see the purity of the spirit. So, how it came about? So, we read here this demon Aristasura came to Vrindavan. So, Bhaktivinoda Thakur explained that each of the demons that Krishna killed, there is a specific anartha that that demon represents in us. And so by reading, sometimes we wonder, why do we have to read about the killing of demons? Actually, reading of the killing of demons is extraordinarily glorious. Because when we read about them, we actually kill that anartha that resides within our heart. So each of those demons, Krishna and Janarvata and Sakatasura and like that, all, every demon has a particular inertia, sort of Bhaktivinoda Thakur describes the meaning of each one. So the killing of Aristasura is the killing of the particular inertia that manifests when one becomes proud from following a false religion. Is cheating religion, one becomes prideful, and it goes against the bhakti. And sometimes there is that pride that develops from that, and that specific tendency is killed when we read the pastimes of the Institute. So there's a great benefit. And when we read all of these different pastimes of killing, the demons of the killing, why is it so important for us to study? Sometimes we want to go study to, you know, this pastime, that pastime. These pastimes are very important for us to read. So, in text 2, Aristasura bellowed harshly and pawed the ground. With his tail raised and his eyes glaring, he began to tear up embankments with the tips of his horns, every now and then passing a little stool in the earth. So, Aristasura, what he's saying, he came at the dusk time, you know, the early evening was starting. And Krishna, he was getting ready, was preparing to perform one of the Rasalila pastimes. So Krishna was getting ready to perform that pastime. And Aristasura came. Aristasura was a demon, and he came in the form. All the demons in Tantra, they came in different forms. And they were persons who were then, by their mystic power, a doing, you know, different forms like the mother, like the cloud, like, you know, the cart, all these things. So in this, Aristasura took the form of a bull. And he created such a dust storm, very high, the dust was flowing because of his moving of his hood, and he was creating such a thunderous sound with his bellowing, and his horns were digging up the ground, creating great fear. Later in this verse, he explained that the strident reverberation of his roar was so frightened the pregnant cows and women that they lost their fetuses in mischief. It was extraordinary fear that was created. And Aristasura creating this fear. Where did everybody go when they were in fear? That's where everybody went. Everybody is the only source of our shelter. And so in great fear, they went to Krishna. Krishna, Krishna, help us! We search out so many other places for our help. Krishna is the only source of our help. So the residents of Vrindavan, they called out to Krishna. Krishna said, "Don't worry, what's to be afraid? I'll take care of it." And this is Sura. So, Krishna will, you know, pat his arms. "All right, let's go." And then he puts his hand on one of his friend's shoulder and he's staring at the demon like this. Krishna would do very cute things. When he was a young child, baby, he would do, you know, he was going to pick up some pot or something. He would, when he was 2 years old, he would tighten his belt and he'd do this. "Look, Mama!" And then he would pick up his thing and Mother Yashoda would just melt in cuteness, overwhelmed in sleep. Krishna performed these pastimes, you know, just to give my mothers are always very proud when their child can do something new for the first time, right? It's like the highlight of the day, week, month. "Oh, my child did this!" It goes on Facebook and WhatsApp and all that. Yeah? And then likes. And like that, Krishna knows, Mother Yashoda enjoys. So he will perform these pastimes. So you know, slapping on the arms, all these times very amusing. He will do this throughout, even when he goes to fight the wrestler. He ties his belt and as if he needs to tie his belt. With just his mind, he can destroy those demons. And he's playing like that. So like that, he prepares. So Aristasura becomes very angry. And he's puffing and puffing and, you know, getting his, he's taking one of his hooks and grinding him to the ground. And he begins to charge at Krishna. You know, with his sharp horns pointing at him. And Krishna's just moving out of his hands. You know, when an enemy is trying to invoke fear in you, you don't become fearful, they become more angry, right? Because the desired effect is not happening, right? So he's running at him, and he's like, Krishna's just smiling, hanging out with his friend, waiting for Aristasura to come closer. And as soon as he comes, he grabs him by the horn and throws him. He's exactly how many? 18 feet. Because his rough numbers there, about 6 yards. Amazing how they call it. Precision is given in there. So Aristasura, you know, goes not defeated. When Krishna defeats us the first time, we don't take our lessons. Right? How easily the Aristasura, like a elephant, plays with a flower. But Aristasura is like, "Oh, I'll get him this time." Like that. So we see so many demons attacking Krishna over and over and over again. Yes? So the demon comes back and Krishna says, "Enough!" And he takes his horn, throws it to the ground with his foot, and then rips off the horn and very gruesomely kills him. But when we see the gruesomeness, we should see that it's a gruesome attack of our emotions. The removal of that emotion. We don't want to be gentle in pulling it out. We want to rip it out. Fierce and ferocious and as quickly as Krishna destroyed the Aristasura. So the Aristasura demon let out a big scream and died. And then the residents of Vrindavan, "Oh, Krishna saved us again." Just another, put it in the story book. Krishna was constantly saving them. And like this, so Krishna carried on with Balaram. they went to Kalyan. They were on their way, and Krishna was on his way to the throne, huh? Pastime of the Rasa there. So Krishna approached the gopis and they were expecting Krishna, but Srimati Radharani and the gopis, the food of Srimati Radharani and Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur gives a very nice description of this in verse 16 of this chapter. If you want to read, I'll just summarize it. But there's a nice almost 20 verses describing this pastime. Very sweet. So Srimati Radharani says that, you know, when Krishna went to them, they said, "Oh, stay away. And she was like, "What? This is a bird? Normally I blow my flute in the middle of the forest and all the gopis come running, regardless of where they are. Just drop everything and come running. And now he is being refused? What happened?" A bull. You are Govinda. You are the giver of pleasures to the cows. Yes, you killed the cow. A demon. No. The demon took the shape of a bull, a male cow. That is considered a sin. And you must atone. And I think I'll give Krishna a big test to atone. So he said, you must bathe in all the holy rivers of the world, the universe, in order to atone for this sin. Killing a cow is no ordinary, a bull is no ordinary sin. Krishna says, really? So with the heel of his foot, he just makes an indentation in the ground. And this giant hole comes. And then he calls all the holy rivers, one by one. And they fill the hole with water. And Krishna says, these are all filled with holy rivers. They've all come and filled my rivers. Radharani says, I don't see any holy people. Who are you talking about? What you don't see? So his two points follow him. And each of them introduced, I am Ganga, I am Saraswati, I am Godavari, I am Sundar. In this way, all the rivers announced themselves, presented themselves in very beautiful form, the personification. In each of the holy rivers, there's a person, they are personified. And so they presented themselves and things like And so Krishna has built this beautiful kund filled with all the holy water from the whole universe. And Krishna is feeling very proud. He uses the word arrogant and thinking, I have built a kund. And he says, Radharani, you haven't done any sacrifice to please Lord Brahma on this earth. What have you done? I'll build a kund also. So just next to that, Aristasura, when he attacked, had made a little indentation with his hook. So Radharani and all her friends, she has lots of friends, began to dig from that hole. And they took their bangles off. And with their bangles, they dug a big hole. And said that, now I have the hole. And Krishna said, okay, then you can bring my water, so fill your kund also, no problem. No? You bathed in that water, and now it has all of your sins from killing the bull. We won't touch that water. We don't want that water contaminating our kund. No way. So, where you'll get water? You'll get water from Manasi Ganga. Manasi Ganga is several kilometers away from this place. And Srimati Radharani has billions of friends. So they made a long line. And they're all with the Manasi Ganga. In the pot, they would dip, and they were handing it back and forth, all the way back, and they were filling the stream. But after quite some time, still very little was happening, all the gopis were getting tired, and they were perspiring, and it was getting late, now into the evening. And so Krishna knew he would not listen to her. Him. He said, just please take these waters. So he looked over to the personification of giving so much happiness to Krishna. And he presents himself and says that, you know, I would be most fortunate if you would fulfill my desire. And what is your desire? My life would be complete if you would allow us to also occupy your kuna, our water for your guidance. Being very merciful, then finally acquiesce and allow the water from Sanskrit to flow into Radha Kunda. And a small hole broke between the embankment of the two kunas, and they became filled. Still today, there is a connection between Radha Kunda and Sanskrit. So Radha Kunda became filled this way with the same water. And there it was Krishna who declared that this kunda is as dear to me as you, yourself. And he promised, he said, I will bathe in this kunda every day. And I perform many pastimes. And then Radharani reciprocated by saying, I will bathe in your kunda every day. And in this way, Radha Kunda became the most nectarian place of Krishna kunda. So Krishna kunda was overflowing here in Radha Kunda. And so devotees will go to Vrindavan and they will offer their pranams to Radha Kunda and sprinkle Radharani and the gift of chanting beings in Radha Kunda. And we are very fortunate because Raghunath Das Goswami, when he came to Vrindavan, he used his access to wealth and constructed a platform and a place. He wanted to make it very convenient for all devotees to come and access that. It was not so accessible prior to that, so he established a very nice platform all around. And his Samadhi Mandir was right on the left, very, very perfect. So if you go to Radha Kunda, first to offer obeisances to Raghunath Das Goswami, Samadhi, Chandler, his Samadhi, there is a 24/7 Kirtan going, and then you can. Very, very auspicious. His appearance is very, very important to us. And his presence. Now, you may wonder, in this verse, it says if one takes back once in Radha Kunda, one Krishna prema is guaranteed. And maybe some of you have been, but taken back is even just drinking three droplets, he should have done. And how come it didn't happen? And it happened for all of you, it didn't happen for me. Have you? Why not? Is it not true? There's a question about faith. Is there faith in that statement? Is faith in Radha Kunda? Then it can happen. So while the process may not have yet manifested, it will. Once our faith comes. Because if we actually have full faith, Krishna prema is guaranteed by taking back the water. Why are we all sitting here? What do we have to do? Oh, I have to get groceries tomorrow. I have to do it. Krishna prema is truly the topmost object of this whole universe. Why do we have to do it? So we know we still develop Krishna. But we can pray for Srimati Radharani that we can have darshan of the most beloved Radha Kunda. We can be very grateful to Srila Prabhupada for introducing us to this Radha Kunda and this important manifested after the slaying of the Arista, of Arista, the Bull King. To Radha Kunda manifest in the material world. But it originates in? So yesterday was the disappearance day of Srila Prabhupada. And as I mentioned, this is the most celebrated festival in the world. We celebrate birthdays, but we don't celebrate death days. But our Acharya's comment in Narasimha's talk was seen that the disappearance and appearance of our Acharya's is non-different. They are equally glorious because we do not think in material world of terms, birth and death. But in fact, it is the beginning of their lila and the end of their lila. That they are equally glorious and to be equally Prabhupada in his gift to us is incomprehensible what we have received in Sri Prabhupada. The mercy, extraordinary compassion he had, and what he endured, the qualities of the devotees, his tolerance, his humility, his enthusiasm, and his determination. You won't really appreciate what Srila Prabhupada did until you turn the age of 70. Then you might get a glimpse as to what he did. And if you read Prabhupada Ramakrishna, which is, I should say, a must read for all devotees in this time, to read the life biography and story of there you'll get a really in-depth appreciation for what Sri Prabhupada gave us and what he endured. Because sometimes in familiarity, it breeds contempt. We don't appreciate how many of Sri Prabhupada's books. Well, how they came to us. Purple effort. How everyone was resting. He was up in the middle of the night, 12 a.m. to 4 a.m. 70, 75, 78, up to 82 years old. On the last day of his affair, he is providing purport to the Bible. Those books are our whole life and actually the resource to bring about the purport. He traveled the world to spread this knowledge. He established these temples, these spiritual hospitals, so that we will have a place to associate, to gain strength in the practice of the new testimony. He taught the process of spiritual life by his own example. That is the definition of acharya. The meaning of the word acharya means one who preaches by action. So every step of Srila Prabhupada's life was an instruction. Everything he did was exactly according to the principle. Nothing he did just whimsically. Every color design, every fine detail of what we did. Why we sing Guru Vastaka prayer as in Mangalati. Because it's explained that one who sings Guru Vastaka prayer during the Brahma Mocha time is guaranteed service to Krishna and Goloka Vrindavan. That's what Goloka wanted to give us back to your family. That we sing this in Mangalaya, that way it's guaranteed. He gave us the morning program. Why we have arti, then we worship Krishna Maharaj, then we have japa, then we have Guru Sutra, and then Shri Bhagavatam. in that order, why those five things? Because Rupa Goswami said in Mathura Devotion, these five things are the most potent aspects of devotional service. If one does any of these five, one can awaken Bhava Bhakti Nature. If you give it a chance, you set up right in the beginning, this is for him. Why he put so much effort into these books? Because Bhakti Siddhanta Sotakapa said, this is the real Madanga. The book, the message of the book can cross oceans. Now 70 languages are hearing this message. The Srila Prabhupada brought it from Sanskrit to English. And from English it has gone to all the different languages. And still, devotees are being cultivated by Srila Prabhupada. Just through his book. His teaching is still alive. You don't think, oh, he's gone. He's not teaching. No. When you read Srila Prabhupada's purport, he is directly speaking to us. Extremely contribution. And we should reflect on Srila Prabhupada's contribution to our life. Because with some reflection, we then can hold on to some teachings. And again, in familiarity, it often becomes difficult. So we should not let that happen. We should fight with great vigor that tendency to take for granted the extraordinary gift we have in the Srila Prabhupada's contribution. He is our whole life. There is no existence. I can say no meaningful existence for our Srila Prabhupada. None. That may seem a stretch, but when you really think about it, and if you truly are objective, you'll see there is no meaning in our life but the Srila Prabhupada has taught and has given and has still given. So we should reciprocate the Srila Prabhupada. And the best meaning to reciprocate the Srila Prabhupada's gift to us is to pay it for us. His desire was to fulfill the order of his devotion in us. The desire that we get fulfilled taking them off of this thoughtful nature. That in every town and village, the Holy Name of the Lord would be chosen. And so Srila Prabhupada made a giant step forward. He did all the hard work. And he left, you know, us to just carry it forward. Just take everything he was given and just take it door to door, village to village. And fulfill the prophecy of taking the Mahaprabhu name. And that our whole Guru Parampara works so hard for. And so if we want to appreciate Srila Prabhupada, we can do so by spreading his message. Because that was his desire. And so this is a movement, not an idle institution. It's a movement. And he's not here for us to just sit and enjoy the time. That is great. It is meant to inspire us to purify ourselves into our capacity to share with others. And just sharing the message of Srila Prabhupada is all we have to do. It's so simple. All we have to do is be the postman and deliver this message to anyone and everyone who can take it. And that would be the ultimate and greatest reciprocation of the truth of Srila Prabhupada. That's what we want. And that's what we can do. So we can pray and understand that we can have the strength and courage and humility and enthusiasm and perseverance to do whatever we can in the capacity to bring us to the mercy.